to be the last thing on my mind. Yeah, I was all but lost in the moment. I was young and running wide open. It was just another summer night. Had to be the last thing on my mind. When love I said I'm yours, the first time I called you Lord. You hit the mark.
When love
feels perfect, other days it just ain't working. The good, the bad, the right, the wrong, and everything in between. Yo, it's crazy, amazing, we can turn our heart through the words we say. Mountains crumble with every syllable, hope can live or die. So speak life. It's twisted. Other days my thoughts just fall apart. I do, I don't, I will, I won't. It's like I'm drowning in the deep. Well,
Well, it's crazy to imagine words from our lips as the arms of compassion. Mountains crumble with every syllable. Hope can live or die. So speak life. You say, raise your thoughts a little higher. Use your words to inspire. Joy will fall like rain when you speak life with the things you say. Lift your head a little higher. Spread the love like fire. Hope will fall like rain when you speak life with the words you say. So speak life.
Last night put the heavy on me. Woke up and I'm feeling lonely. This world got a way of showing me. Some days it'll lift you up. Some days it'll call you bluff. Man, most of my days I ain't got enough. And all I know is you're my only hope.
I'm here this morning. A little bit loud. We get it back down on the. Well, good morning and welcome to First Baptist Church today. We're glad that you have assembled, not only in this place of worship known as First Baptist Church, but also those of you who are listening by radio or watching on social media. We're glad that you're part of our services today. I'd ask that you would join with me as we just simply ask God to speak to us during this worship time, during these private moments as God speaks to you, as well as we celebrate a very important part of the ministry of our church and working with students during the summer months known as Vacation Bible School. Many of the children have been in attendance, and we're grateful that God has spoken to them as well. So let's pray together. Father, we have assembled here today as your people, to worship, to make our requests through prayers known to you, to hear your voice speak to us in that quiet, small way that you constantly make us aware that there is a God who has created the universe. We're grateful for the beautiful creation that we live in, the beauty of the colors, the freshness of the air. And we'd all join in unison in asking that you send great rains to the state of New Mexico. God, we're grateful for how you answer our prayers now and in the days to come. For it's in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. We're grateful for those who are leading us in worship and the children that are here. God bless you as you lead us in the songs.
worship from our VBS.
Let's get the juices flowing, imagination's going. There's so much in store. It's time to be creative, incredibly innovative, so much to explore.
All right, you may be seated. Ladies, thank you. So we have had an amazing 4 days of VBS. Tonight is our last night, and we're going to show you a quick video, but I want to share just a few praises. We've had 43 students attending, which is pretty awesome. Yeah. And on our ABC night, Friday night, we had 9 kids saved and 4 kids recommitted. Yes, so that's pretty amazing. All right, enjoy our video.
As you can tell, we've had a high energy week in the life of this church with the young children that have been involved, but not only children, but many of the adults, and some of them even we would consider retirement age people, but I don't really believe in retirement, you know that. I think people transition into new positions, new places of leadership and life of a congregation, and then to assist in the ministry of telling the next generation the importance of knowing Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Those of you who are here may not be aware that this is getting closer and closer to the time that I will not be serving as pastor of this church, as I am going to be taking a new position with Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary, and then I will also be traveling tomorrow to be in Washington, D.C. with the Family Research Council, and a project that we'll be working on, and that is in the area of a biblical worldview center, and be engaged in developing churches all across America. And there's a reason for that. I had the privilege of meeting and getting to know George Barna, who does a great deal of the research in Christian circles, and 6% of people in the United States have a biblical worldview. Sad part about it is 37% of the pastors in our nation are the ones that have a biblical worldview. So the rest of them do not. We're in a crisis time in our nation. And the title of the message that I'm delivering today is Waking Up to the World of Warfare. It has been my passion over the last several weeks to prepare this church in its transition. And I am going to address that issue today. And I'd ask that you take your Bibles and turn with me to 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter. And we'll be reading from a selected verse of Scripture and focusing on the task that we have, and that is fighting the good fight. Now, I'm going to read some passages from the Scriptures that really not on the screen, but we're going to focus on this verse, chapter 6 and verse 12 of 1 Timothy. We stand in awe of God's Word as we read it together. Now, I firmly believe that a man who stands in the pulpit of a church preaches the Bible and believe that the Bible is the Word of God. We're not here to argue whether or not it is a myth or some story that somebody dreamed up. We believe that God inspired people to write the Bible. And 1 Timothy is written beginning in verse 11, "But you, man, O God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. And verse 12 says, "Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of eternal life, which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses." Father, we've assembled here this morning as your people. Assembled as people who believe the Bible to be your word and you speak to every generation. We as a church have had a ministry known as Vacation Bible School, and we've been teaching children the truths of Scripture. We've teaching them to memorize it, to hide their word, your words in their heart, that they may not sin against you. Grateful for this church and its ministry through the years, not only of reaching children, but touching the lives of their parents, sharing the gospel message, encouraging people to accept Christ, and seeing the miracle of conversion take place in our very eyes. Continue to bless First Baptist Church. May we say it's our church. God has led us to be a part of kingdom work. In the name of Jesus, we ask these things. Amen. Thank you for standing in honor of God's Word today. In the time that I have this morning, there is never enough time, but the focus on this concept of fighting the good fight of faith. And We are in a major warfare in our time. Like you, I have been quite concerned when we enter into a pandemic, and we have prayed that God would bring a great healing in our land, that we would have vaccines developed that would help us and not contract the virus, or at least not contract it to the point that it would take our lives. Many have lost family members, but our church family has been safe and protected, and I firmly believe it is by the grace of God. People have died in our church family, but not that many during the pandemic, but nobody died of the dreaded virus. They had other complications. But what's more important is spiritual death that is taking place in our nation, because we are in a major battlefield at the present time. As I have viewed recent developments and have read and studied in the direction of the church, I see the church in four major areas today. You have what is known as the woke church, and if you don't understand woke, it is a driven to be aware of racial injustices that have been done in the past and continue today. But it is pointed at an ethnic group, and churches are going woke, and that is the term. You want to look up what it means, you can look up what woke means, and you can discuss what is a woke church. And I think it's detrimental to the church. When you hear a word such as Black Lives Matter, I would agree, Black Lives Matter. But I believe that Brown Lives Matter, and I believe that Red Lives Matter, and I believe that Yellow Lives Matter. I don't accept the underlying platform that is under Black Lives Matter. Critical race theory, I do not accept critical race theory. It may offend somebody in this room. But God is the one who created the races of man. All lives need to be redeemed, because all men are sinners, regardless of their ethnicity, regardless of the color of skin, and regardless where they live or the language that they speak. That's why we as Baptists have sent missionaries to every people group in the world, and continue to do so until Jesus comes back. So there is the woke churches. There is the wandering churches. I mean, I'm talking about wandering. They're just wandering around. They don't know what to do. They don't understand the times. They're just kind of sitting and waiting and dying. Then there is the watching church. Well, at least they're watching. They're watching, but they're not doing anything. They're not engaging in their culture. And I have made this statement more than once, and among Baptist leadership on a national scale, if you really want to understand the culture, spend a week teaching Vacation Bible School, because you'll learn the culture. You'll know what's going on with the parents. You'll know what's going on with the grandparents. You'll know what's going on in the kids' lives. You'll know what's going on in school. You will know quickly what the culture is. You teach children for a week. That's all it takes. Then I believe there is the awakening church. Not only does the awakening church understand times, but they know exactly what they need to do. And I want to ask you to continue to pray that this church is part of the remnant, the awakening church in our time, to be able to understand that we have a task until Jesus returns. And we are concerned about our nation. We're concerned about the world events. I've been more concerned about it than you can ever imagine. Because I do have two sons in the military, and we pray for them on a regular basis and what God may be wanting to do in their lives serving our country. And defending the freedom that you have today to assemble in a church, to worship God as your conscience dictates. So this morning I'm going to focus on an awakening church and a waking up to a world of warfare in the time that I have remaining to speak. We are at war. We're at war spiritually. Spirituality, theologies that are in the world, the political movements that are taking place to destroy freedom that you and I hold dearly. Oswald Sanders, in his timely volume, Satan is No Myth, says, the consistent theme of the Bible from the beginning to the end is the conflict between good and evil, between God and the devil. It begins with the serpent in the book of Genesis, and it ends with the devil in the lake of fire in Revelation, the 20th chapter. We know that we're going to win the battle. We know that we are in a warfare and that God is in control of the universe. We're just in between all this stuff and how to live in it. Often I firmly believe that a Christian hears very little to encourage him or her, or even to equip to be engaged as a born-again believer in the time of which we live. We've almost run up the surrender flag. We've run it up in our school systems. We've run it up in our Congress and in our Senate. We have run up the surrender flag in our states and our county governments and our city council meetings. And we need to awaken as a people and understand that the lives are at stake are the very young children that we have seen a video about who have been here singing this morning. We would rather let our children do most anything in the world but study the Word of God and to memorize it and understand it and apply it to their life. And I praise God for people who took from their busy schedules, because all of us are busy. If you're raising a family, if you've got a job, if you're trying to find groceries and find a time to shop, you are a busy person, but all people are busy, but they took from their schedules to help teach the Scriptures, which we're going to be doing that in the next few minutes in the Bible study time that we have with children, and then tonight again as we conclude this thrust of ministry in the life of our church. America has had an onslaught of witchcraft, Satanism, spiritualism that have invaded our land like a flood tide. Eastern religions have found a new foothold in the land of the free and the home of the brave. And my statement today, fight the good fight of faith. Endure the hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. In 2 Timothy, the second chapter and verse 3, Paul was writing this to prepare a church to understand the relationship that Paul had with his young Timothy, who might have been in his late teens, early 20s at best, to be a pastor of a church. This church is looking for a new pastor to take the mantle of being the next leader, the next under-shepherd, the next elder, the next bishop, whatever term you'd like to choose to use, but we choose to call it pastor of the church. And that pastor, I would trust that you'll find a man who believes the Bible to be the Word of God and to preach it with all clarity. Endure the hardship as a soldier of Jesus Christ. In 2 Timothy, the second chapter, in verse 3, it speaks to us. We have to endure the battle. You'll find in the book of 2 Timothy, the fourth chapter, verse 7, I have fought a good fight, I have kept the faith. See, he's writing to a church. And as he's writing to a church, though we walk in flesh, we do not do war after the flesh, for the weapons of the warfare are not carnal, but mighty hand of God to pulling down the strongholds, casting down the imaginations. We have a God who realizes that we are in this spiritual battle, a warfare that is trying to destroy everything that we would know and hold dear as in an American. Recently, there has been an article written about the institutions that are under attack. It doesn't make any difference what the institution is. If it's an institution, some people declare it bad or evil. You realize that everything has some kind of process to work under and to supervise and to guide and to develop, whether it be a public school system or a private school system, whether it be a Fortune 500 company or even the local church. In the local church, it's called polity. And we are an independent church that chooses to cooperate with the Southern Baptist Convention, the Baptist Convention of New Mexico, the Western Baptist Association, and sister churches of like faith. We are a church that is independent and self-governing. No hierarchy tells us who's going to be the next pastor of the church. The congregation does. We sense that God is leading us to a man, and we are trusting that God is leading a man toward this church. And please understand, I've invested 28 years of my life. I am concerned about this church until Jesus returns or he calls all of us home. I made that commitment. When I came here as pastor, I'm making that commitment as my time is coming short of being your pastor, though I will always have a great love relationship with this church. But we are in a battle. Jesus said in Matthew, the 10th chapter, verse 34, "Think not that I've come to send peace on earth. I have not come to send peace, but a sword." We are in a continuous battle for the souls of our children and the souls of our grandchildren. We are in a battle for the souls of the children that grow up in our towns and our communities. And we need to awaken to the fact that there is an evil one out there that it desires to destroy the souls and the minds and the inner being known as a heart of an individual. Peter tells us that we need to be sober and vigilant, knowing our adversary, the devil, who is like a roaring lion and walks about seeking to whom he may devour. That's found in 1 Peter, the 5th chapter, in verse 8. Nowhere in the Bible or is this subject to the spiritual warfare treated more seriously than in Ephesians, the 6th chapter. When he addresses that issue, and technically, he tells us that we need to wake up to the warriors in this warfare. We already understand that we are in a great battle against the forces of evil. But we need to understand that when we accept Christ as our Savior and Lord, we just signed up. We have signed up to be a follower of Christ, to be a soldier in God's army. And that is a maturing process. Just like we wouldn't send young children into battle, but they need to prepare for the battle. And they need to have filters put in place. And parents need to have filters. We have basically turned a generation loose with a phone that they can go anywhere in the world with, look at anything they want to, if it's not monitored and watched closely by parents. Same thing with internet on your home computers. We realize that the warriors are facing what is known as a destructive force. We have been warned. The thief, the devil, comes not to steal and to kill, but to destroy. In John 10th chapter and verse 10. Do you realize that today, I hope you leave here angry at the evil one because he's wanting to destroy your family, your sons and daughters, your daughter-in-laws and son-in-laws, your grandchildren. That is on the altar of the evil one who is trying to destroy the very core fabric of this nation and this world. I firmly believe that the defeat is almost in past tense. We've not allowed ourselves to rise up in our homes. We choose to get angry at the preachers when they preach the Bible. I've known churches who have meetings with their pastor to dictate what he's going to preach from the pulpits. And sometimes some of them need to be addressed. They preach movies and stories and not preaching literally the scripture verses as God intended. We're not alone. We have to realize all through the Bible, Old and New Testament, there were those who were engaged in this evil world that is so destructive. You'll find that in Daniel's life, a young man who was brought off into captivity and who took time and stood for his principles and prayed to his God, even though it would cost him imprisonment. In Ephesians, the sixth chapter, tells us that we must wake up to the warfare, the wardrobe of the warfare, and we need to put it on. Now, I don't have time to deal with all this morning, but I want to address the issue of the girdle of truth. Truth refers to the truthfulness and integrity and sincerity. As Peter joins in and writes to the hearers, you must gird up the loins of your mind. In 1 Peter, the first chapter in verse 13, the battlefield is for the mind of our children. And they need to know that there is truth. Just because it's popular and just because everybody thinks it's right doesn't make it right. There are things that God had intended and teaches us in His Word, and we need to be students of the Word to understand the difference between truth and a lie. Our children need to be taught that. You have to put on the breastplate of righteousness. The right standing with God results in right behavior. One of the big challenges that we have is to teach children not only to be converted to Christ, but they repent of their sin and go a different direction than the kids at school. From cheating on tests to the language that they use. When I talk to public school teachers today, you know one of the things that I hear most often? The language in the schools are horrendous. The foulness that they talk back to their teachers. You know, I don't know what happened to a generation, but I can remember having my mouth washed out with soap. Now, I don't know if that means anything to this body and this group of people here or even listening. And I can remember when the soap got worse. We went from bath soap to lava. And then if that didn't work, there was another institution of capital punishment, if you want to call that. That's what I thought it was, corporate punishment. But you're going to watch your mouth. That just seems like a small thing now, but there's a lack of respect for people who are teaching today. Whether it be in a Sunday school class in church or a public school classroom. But we take on the breastplate of righteousness, and it's a right standing with God and right behavior. The footwear of preparation and the gospel of peace. One of the things I do know about being in the military, and especially if you're a ground pounder or anybody else in the military, it is vitally important that you take care of your feet. There have been wars lost because a soldier cannot march and fight. The earliest of armies in the world understood the importance of taking care of a soldier's feet, having the proper footwear, and battles were won because soldiers could move quickly, and their feet carried them into battle. We need to take care of our strategic issues that are the foundation that we build upon and use them in the battle of spiritual warfare. There is what's known as the shield of faith. A Roman shield was made out of brass covered with leather, oblong, measured 4 feet by 2 feet and 2.5 feet. And it was designed to protect the physical body. Shields were dipped in water in order to quickly quench the flaming darts of the enemy. And there are constantly darts being flown at us every day of our life from every message group that you can imagine. The helmet of salvation guards the mind, which is a special target of the devil. Unguarded mind makes Christian soldier easy prey and lies that the devil implants in the brain. This has not been something that has taken place just in a short period of time. I've had this conversation many, many times over the last several weeks. The earliest of higher institutions of learning, we call it Ivy League schools, the very early educational process in America, was to teach people to know and study God's Word. It was designed to help train the clergy for a developing nation. It was designed to help those who were going to teach the next generation to know the truth. And I'm recalled of the passage in the Scripture that says, "The truth shall set you free." Many of our universities have almost denied God, mocked the Bible. And there are some who are making a call back to that in our time of which we live even now. But the armor of God is vital for us as individuals to put on this armor and go into battle. Our great salvation is the helmet of salvation, and it guards the mind. We must wake up to the weaponry of warfare. The Word of God. The word Logos is used to refer to the written Word. And I'm so encouraged to see our Bible school teachers have Bibles on the tables and encouraging their students to bring their own Bibles and to open the pages of the Bible and to read it during vacation Bible school. Do you realize that students are not reading anymore? I mean, they're not reading anything. I don't even know if they read comic books anymore. Everything's on the phone. And they're watching movies on the phone. And they're watching things that poison their mind when we need to teach children how to open the Word of God and to understand there is an Old Testament and a New Testament. There are 39 books of the Old Testament. There are 27 books of the New Testament. You have the Gospels, and you have the history, and you have the epistles, and you have the letters from Paul. And you understand the Bible and the message that is taught. And you know that is a parent issue. Technically, last Sunday is going to be Father's Day, and I am going to be preaching to the men of the church. I want the men to be here. Can you make a commitment right now you'll be here on the 19th of June? I need the guys to say amen. I need to see the men here because I'm going to address an issue that we're addressing in masculinity in America today. It may be my parting message, but if we don't rise up God-honoring, God-fearing men in our society, we're not going to have a society to worry about, or a country, or a freedom that we realize. That's another time. So we must wake up to the weaponry of the warfare, which is the Word of God and how it speaks to every generation. Revelation 12, chapter verse 11 says, "And they overcame him," the devil, "by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they love not their lives even to death." Somewhere along the line, we started apologizing to people that our Constitution were written by God-honoring men who used the Bible as a textbook for their life. They understood it. You can call them deists, you can call them anything you want to, but they were men who understood the Word of God and applied it when they wrote the Constitution of the United States of America. Somewhere we have lost that in teaching it in our schools, in our children. You know, I'm going to say something about my youngest son. On the 4th of July, every 4th of July, they read the Constitution at breakfast time in their home. I'm proud of him because he's instilling in his wife and his two sons why he serves our nation. Because he gave an oath to defend the Constitution of the United States of America against all enemies, foreign and domestic. And right now we are dealing with domestic enemies who are trying to destroy this country and the freedom that we have to come up to this church and even say a pledge to the American flag and a pledge to the Christian flag and to honor God when we say, "I pledge allegiance to the Bible." That's what we need to do. And we need to awaken to the Word of God, how it speaks to every generation. We must wake up to the waging of this warfare. Understanding the enemy. Engaging. Understanding the equipment. Being dressed for warfare. But building our lives spiritually. And it begins with our prayer and supplications. And pray in the Spirit in all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. There's all kinds of prayers. There's prayers of praise. There's prayers of thanksgiving. There's prayers of what we call petitions, when we make our requests known to God that affects our lives and the things that are taking place in our life. There's intercession prayers when we pray on behalf of other people. I can honestly tell you, I hope that I would continue to have the prayers of the people of First Baptist Church, because the arena that I'm about to enter into is a very vicious arena. And we, as a Christian people, must engage in the battle that we're in. We cannot no longer just be sitting around in the pews, no longer be just sitting around waiting for something to happen. Let the preachers do it, or let whoever else does it. We need to be responsible for our families and our churches and our institutions that have meant so much to us in our lifetime. Many of us have made our livelihood because of the institutions that we have committed our lives to. So we have the warfare of continuous prayers. Praying like we've never prayed before in our life. Praying for our children and our grandchildren. Mentioning them by name. Engaging in them with spiritual activities in our homes. I had a man that I've known in my past who had grandparents week. And they get the grandkids, and there is there's one camp rule. No parents allowed. So the grandparents take their grandkids, and they go, and they do what we would call a backyard Bible club at grandparents week. They go off to a camp, and they study the Bible. They memorize the scriptures. They have fun playing games. They go swimming. They do all, and they get to do things that, you know, grandparents let their grandkids do, like have ice cream for breakfast. But the importance of it is teaching their children that there is a God. And they teach them how to pray. They don't spend a whole time doing it, but they emphasize that as a grandparent. And we need to rekindle things like that in our Christian community. Waging warfare through playing inclusive. You know, our praise, our thanksgiving, our confession of sin, and intercession on behalf of others, our petitions, of course. And then waging warfare through the intensive and in supplication. Some things are not going to take place unless there is prayer and fasting. And I firmly think that we need to re-engage in the discipline of fasting. Fasting a meal. Now, that doesn't mean we just, you know, fast a meal and, you know, what commonly was called watch soap operas or watch something on a phone. We set aside a lunch time, or we set a breakfast time aside to pray. That's prayer and fasting. And then we get up and go about our daily work. Waging warfare is through prayer accompanied by watchful perseverance. Alert, our place of battle in our economy, the places where we live, our work, that's the economy. Our schools, that's our economy. The governing people, that's our economy. All those things affect our lives. And we engage in it, and when there's something wrong, we address it. Can you imagine the politicians that would listen to us if 500 of their constituents sent them a letter or an email from our personal email, from our personal address, saying this bill is wrong? Or 5,000? Or 50,000? That's what gets attention in politicians. because they know how many people vote in their constituency. They know who votes and when they vote, and they often how frequently they vote, and they're going to listen to people who vote. And it's time for the Christian church to rise up and say, we are going to take back what we have lost. And let's wake up to winning this warfare. You know, I like sports. It doesn't make any difference what sports. I like basketball, baseball. Did I mention football? I like sports. But you know what's really fun about sports? It's when your team wins. You know, it really is. I mean, you go to a ball game or you buy a ticket or watch it on television, listen to it on the radio. And if we know somebody that's playing, we want them to have a great game. Nobody gets hurt. But, man, don't we feel good when our team wins. We love that. Now, I've often thought about it. Wouldn't it be fun to know who wins before they played? You know, so we wouldn't get all nervous and upset about it and throw stuff across the room and jump up and holler and say, no way, you know, all that kind of stuff. Well, we know who's going to win. You know, I kind of like watching those games that I know who won. You know, so you watch it. Hey, my team won. That's great. Fast forward if you want to. Just watch the fun plays. We already know who's going to win. Why is such an intensity of struggle? If the devil is defeated, why don't we ultimately win? Because we're in a battle for the individual souls. We had a young girl made a decision for Christ, and we're going to baptize her in 11 o'clock service. You realize that that's the one that the evil one didn't get? That's what we're trying to do. I like to refer to this as the aluminum can picker-uppers. Now, I don't even know how you might say that right in English, but that's what it communicates well, doesn't it? You ever watch people picking up aluminum cans? Now, there's another story like that. It's about starfish person. You know, the forested starfish person was walking along the beach, saw a starfish, picked it up, and threw it into the ocean, and says, well, there's thousands of starfish on the beach. Yeah, what difference does it make? Well, it made a difference to the one we threw back. We pick up aluminum cans. We recycle aluminum cans. Well, what difference does it make? Well, we picked up one can. We got that one. It's kind of what we're doing with humanity. We're picking up people who are broken and destroyed and seem to have no hope. Do you realize that we're all there and we're all broken and we're all being destroyed? But when the grace of God comes in our life, all of a sudden we have value and purpose and direction in our life. We are a child of the King. We are no longer being cast aside and destroyed by the evil one because we're now a child of God. And I'm appealing to all the children of God, especially the ones who are members of First Baptist Church of Gallup, New Mexico, to engage in the battle and fight the good fight of faith until he calls you home or Jesus returns. But we're salvaging the souls of men and women, boys and girls, one at a time. Are you ready to join in? Are you going to put on a uniform? Are you going to put on the battle gear and go into battle for the kingdom of God and your Savior? Oh, I've been so busy this week, I just haven't had time. You know, I don't like Deacon Jones down to church. And you know that woman that gets up and bosses everybody around? I don't like her either. I just think I'm going to retire from church. Doesn't that sound like modern Christianity today? While the battle is enraging outside our homes. But it's not just outside our homes, it's in our homes. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord until Jesus calls us home. Some boys and girls have made decisions to follow Christ, may need to make a public decision this morning, request baptism and joining the church. There may be parents who've understood for the first time what their children have been studying this week, and they're ready to make a decision. Maybe you have been a follower of Christ for years. I mean, years you've been a follower of Jesus. But it's now time to put on the uniform. And I'm ready, Pastor. Count me in. I'm signing up. I'm re-enlisting. Maybe you felt like you just needed to take a break, but it's time to re-enlist. Lord Jesus, as the people have intensely listened today, I would ask that your Holy Spirit would speak and move their lives to action. Protect them in the battle. Protect them from the onslaughts of the evil one and the fiery darts. Jesus, during this special time, may people make decisions that are life-changing as eternity is at stake. For it's your holy and precious name. Amen. Quietly and reverently as you stand to your feet. Will you stand? Will you step out? Stand firm for Christ today. Sing, please.
Only one has ever lived to give his life as a gift to me and you. Only one has ever died and rose again back to life for me and you. Only one could ever face the cross. Only one could ever save the lost. Who can write his name upon our hearts, and who can give our lives a brand new start?